God our Father, and from our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ, through the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Would you please pray with me? Father in heaven, we give you thanks and praise for leading the Magi to your Son, Jesus, for leading the Magi to you. We ask you, Father, to continue to lead us as well to your Son, to the life that he has given. We ask you to open our hearts and our minds to your leading and your directing this morning, and, Father, to give us the strength to follow. We pray this in Jesus' name. And all God's children say, Amen. Amen. Like I mentioned in the announcements this morning, this is the one day, the one time, very rare, that the day of Epiphany, the actual day of, lands on a Sunday. It is one of the rare days that we can actually celebrate the arrival of the wise men on the day that the church designed hundreds, if not thousands of years ago, to celebrate the arrival of the wise men. We see them, there's three of them that we have in our display right over there. The day that we arrive, the day that we can actually sing, we three kings of Orient are. But I have a question for you. Number one, part one is who were they? And part two, how did they know? That part, the second part, has always boggled my mind. How did they know to ask the question of Herod, do you know where the king of the Jews was to be born? How did they know? There's a lot. Our text does not answer that question. It answers everything else, but that one particular question it does not answer. There's a lot of speculation. But I think there's a couple of options. One of them is, how did they know it was the king of the Jews? Unless they were Jewish themselves. You have to understand a couple of different things. There were two sections of exile in the history of the nation of Israel. The first one was in 722 BC, when the northern half of the nation of Israel was taken by the Assyrians and then just taken away. And then 200 years later, the tribe of Judah was taken captive by the Babylonians, gone. And it was only a remnant, a portion of those Jews that were captured and sent to Babylon, only a portion of them came back. So it is possible that these wise men came back that had Jewish descent. They knew the prophecies. They knew how to read the signs. That's one possible way of how did they know. But here's the things that we do know. They saw a star rise up in the west. They saw something unusual, odd. It did not match anything that they were aware of. All of a sudden, one star just shows up, a light in the heavens, in the western sky, shows up. And I venture to say, the text does not say whether it appeared throughout the day. I think it probably would. It was that important of a sign that it would stay visible even in sunlight. That's unusual because the stars are only visible when the sun recedes. Do we see the other heavenly lights? This one was different. Took them westward. They decided, maybe out of curiosity, maybe initially out of curiosity, or knowledge, or wisdom, we don't know why they left, but they chose to follow. They followed this star in the heavens. Now, we just sang, we three kings. Our text from Matthew leads us not to understand that they were kings. That actually, the king identifier didn't happen until maybe about 500-600 years ago. All we know is that, as Matthew writes it, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem. So we know that they knew. We know that they were wise men. What does wise men actually say? Well, the connotation there simply is this. They could have been spiritual advisors for whoever king they were associated with. We see evidence of that, biblical evidence. Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, had his spiritual advisors. David had his pastor, his spiritual advisor. So there were spiritual advisors, there were pastors out there long before we have taken the title. They could have been wise men because of their position. There's one commentator, as I was reading and getting ready for this morning, one commentator that said the wise men were actually kind of dumb. Okay, I'll bite. Why do you say that? Well, it's because they did something that no wise man would ever do. At least not in an official capacity. They wouldn't leave. They were advisors. They were followers. Okay, I get that. I understand. But let's think about this for a moment. What made them wise? Well, one, I think what made them wise is they were able to, quote-unquote, read the signs. They had an awareness of something odd was happening. The fact of the matter is that they also were wise because they did their homework. Why else would they say to Herod, "Where is he who has been born king of the Jews?" Somebody who wasn't wise wouldn't have figured that one out. But I think what made them wise more than anything else was, after reading the signs, after learning and researching it, they followed. That's what made them wise. That's what made them magi. It's because that they followed. They left their homes. They left their country. They embarked following a star that shone in the sky and never was there before. They followed it. They followed it, and it took them approximately 2 years to get to Jerusalem. And then they were wise again because they listened to the prophecy that was spoken. But you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, you who were small in the stature of Jerusalem, from you and in you is born this king. They were wise to listen and hear and learn. That's what made them, I believe, wise men. So that leads us to ask the question, what about us? We're 2,000 years removed from the event. But I think we need to ask ourselves the question, if we saw something that pointed us to the birth of a Savior, would we respond? Think about it a minute. 2,000 years ago, a heavenly being just shows up out of nowhere. This is visible to everybody. It's not just visible to, quote unquote, three men. Everybody can see it. Why did not everybody respond? We're not sure. Could have been, oh, that's interesting. Move on. Oh, that's a curiosity. Maybe I should look that up and see what it is. And then forget about it. Or they just didn't notice. Strange. That can happen to us too. We've got the signs. We've known the signs, and the church has known the signs for nearly 2,000 years. We know what to look for. Oh, that's nice. Oh, the season of Christmas starts now in October. And oh, it's all about 50% off sales. And it's all about what do you want for Christmas? And it's all about everything else but what the signs have been telling us for nearly 2,000 years. Are we guilty of missing the signs, not seeing it? Are we guilty of missing the boat? In a word, yup, we are. We get caught up. We get caught up in whatever. Sometimes what we get caught up in has a tendency to lead us away from what's right in front of us, right? What right is under our noses. That God continues to reveal. God continues to say, look for the signs. Look what I am revealing to you. Or to use another figure of speech, open the book. Open the book. The signs are there. The signs are there to my Son's physical incarnation, becoming human. The signs are there, and the virgin shall conceive and bear a son. And he will be conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffer under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried, and the third day rise to life. The signs are there. You see, here's the connection. We are wise men and women because we see the signs. Now, to borrow a phrase, wow, that's new. Let me Google it. Or probably better yet, let me get my Bible app. Or let me actually pick up the book. Let's become wise together. Let's learn and grow from what God has to say to us about this child. Let's put together the evidence that He's laid out before us. And let's see everything that God has given to us. Are we seeing everything? No, probably not, because there's filters that we use that kind of keep us from maybe seeing the whole picture. But the bottom line is God revealed enough and shared enough so that we can do one thing. Follow. God's put us out there to follow. So do we follow? No, we don't. mess. There are days when stuff happens, and y'all have days when stuff happens, right? The real world kind of tries to interfere with our walk with God. Distracts us, reprioritizes us a little bit. Maybe that happens. But yet then there's the Word that brings us back. Okay, I'm going to be wise here. What does God want me to do? He wants me to follow. Simple, right? Just to follow. Because the beautiful thing about God is He makes us wise unto salvation. To follow Jesus, like I shared with the second article of the Apostles' Creed. Conceived, born, crucified. To follow Him to the cross. Follow to Jesus and to see where He died, how He died, and more importantly, why He died. And that's to bring to us salvation, forgiveness, grace, mercy, love. And then to watch and follow Him and go to the tomb. Because you know what the tomb is? Empty. It's empty. The tomb is empty because A, He rose from it. B, that's what He gives us, new life. He gives us a new life to live today as well as forever. Just as He was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so shall we be raised by the glory of God the Father and raised to a new life. So, there's two more points I want to share with you. They come under the heading, what does this mean? Okay? We're good Googlers. We ask that question. What does this mean? Well, God makes us wise unto salvation. That's answer number one. God makes us wise unto salvation. He opens our eyes to see. Through faith in the promises of God, He opens our eyes to see what He has done and continues to do in front, right in front of us, right under our noses. He makes us wise until salvation to where we can say, thank you. Or as one member of my former congregation did as I'm preaching, now this man, let me set the stage a little bit. This man would have never spoke out in church at all. Just was not his nature. He grew up in an environment where you sit in church and you say nothing, only when you're supposed to say or pray. I made a point of something, I don't remember what the point was. All of a sudden, Charlie says from the back row, clear as crystal, amen. I was never expecting it out of him. I had to stop for a second and catch my, what? And then I moved on. But the point I use in order to bring it up is, God makes us wise unto salvation. Our life as Christian people is a life of saying to God, amen. Let it be so. Because that's what the Word means. Let it be so. Boom! Exclamation point. Period. Done. And then we follow. That's the second one. And then we follow. We follow by working within the framework of our congregation, the corporate ministry of Faith Lutheran Church and School, and in our daily lives, wherever we work, wherever we go to school, our friends, our family, the people we associate with, we follow God. And if those people around us are observant, they will see something in us. They will see either a different demeanor when stuff happens, when bad things happen, a different point of view, but they will see something when they are observant. And you've heard me say this once before. They will ask the question, why are you not responding as if, like everybody else? What's different? And then we, through God's working, can help them become wise men and women to encourage the faith, to instill the love and grace God has done for us. When God made us wise men and women. In Jesus' name, amen.